and welcome to Saroshi classes. So before moving further, let's have a look at the remaining part of the fourth chapter of class 11, Fine Arts, Introduction to Indian Culture. So here you will see the picture of stupa at Sanchi. Here you can see the dome, and here is the gateway and the structure. Here is the chhatri, so you can have a look at it. So this is basically a Sanchi stupa. So Sanchi, about 50 kilometers from Bhopal and the capital of Madhya Pradesh, is a World Heritage Site. Remember, it is the World Heritage Site. So along with the other relatively small stupas, there are three main stupas at Sanchi. So stupa one is presumed to have the relics of Buddha. And then the second stupa has the relics of the 10 less famous arahats belonging to three different generations, and their names are found on the relic casket. So third stupa has the relics of the Sariputta and the Mahamogalayana. So here you can remember the first stupa has the relics of Buddha, then second stupa has the relics of 10 less famous arhats belonging to the three different generations, and the third stupa has the relics of the Sariputta and the Mahamogalayana. Okay, now the first stupa, known for the carvings on its gateway, here you can see these carvings on the gateway, is one of the finest. So you can observe here how fine these sculptures are. So originally the stupa was a small brick culture which expanded over a period and was covered with a stone, Vedika and Torna. So let me show it to you. Here you will see this is basically the picture. You can see here the dome like structure. It is basically a made up of bricks, and then afterwards it has enhanced and with the due course of time its beauty has been enhanced by the different kings. So This has been said here that originally the stupa was a small brick structure which expanded over a period and was covered with a stone, then Vedikas and Tornas, and these are basically the Tornas. Okay, Torna means the gateway. So Ashokan lion capital pillar with an inscription is found on the southern side of the stupa, indicating how Sanchi became a center of monastic and the artistic activity. Okay, fine. Then what happened is the south gateway was made first, followed by the others, and the Pradakshina Patha around the stupa is covered with the Vedikas, and there is also the upper Pradakshina Patha, which is unique to the site. Now the four gateways are decorated profusely with the sculpture. Buddha is shown symbolically as empty throne, feet, chhatra, stupas, etc. And the toranas are constructed in all four directions. So their stylistic differences indicates their possible chronology from the 1st century BCE onwards. So stupa 1 is the oldest stupa. The carving of the image on the Vedika of the stupa 2nd and earlier than those of the stupa 1. Jatakas also became an important part of the narratives in the stupas, and the figures of the Sanchi, despite being small in the dimensions, show considerable mastery of sculpting. Their physiognomic treatments of body shows both depth and the dimensions, which are very naturalistic, and there are guardian images on the pillars and Shalabhanjika. Okay, Shalabhanjika, which means the lady holding the branch of the tree. Sculptures are remarkable in their treatment of volume and the rigidity of the early sculptures of the stupa 2nd is no more there. Very bad. Anyways, so each torna consists of two vertical pillars and three horizontal bars on the top, and each horizontal bar is decorated with the different sculptural themes on the front as well as at the back. Supporting the extensions of the lowermost horizontal bar from below are the images of Shalabhanjika. Okay, so you have seen here the image of tornas. Okay, so now here you can see the image of the seated Buddha, Katra Mount Mathura. Okay, so here you can see the image of the seated Buddha, Katra Mount Mathura. So here you can see the beautiful carving. Wait, so it will take some time to load. This image will take some time to get load. Okay, so Mathura was a great center. So here you can see the Mathura. This image, this sculpture has been found in the Mathura. So Mathura was a great center for making sculptures during the early historic period, and many images have been found there. So a large number of images dating back to the Kushana period is from Mathura. Remember, a large number of images dating back from the Kushana period is from the Mathura. So a distinct way of sculpting practiced at Mathura makes the images found here different from those at other centers in the country. And the image of the Buddha from the Kathra mound belongs to the second century. Remember, this image belongs to the second century and it represents the Buddha with the two Bodhisattvas attendants. Now the Buddha is seated in the Padmasana. Here you can see the Buddha is seated in the Padmasana. Here you can see the Buddha is seated in the Padmasana. This asana is known as the Padmasana. So the Buddha is seated in the Padmasana, that is cross folded legs, and the right hand is in the Abhaya Mudra, raised a little above the shoulder level, whereas the left hand is placed on the left thigh. The Ushanisha, that is hair knot, is shown with a vertically raised projections. Mathura sculptures from the period are made with the high volume, having fleshy body, and the shoulders are the broad. So Sangati, that is garment, covers only one shoulder and has been made prominently visible, covering the left and the left hand, whereas while covering the torso, the independent volume of the garment is reduced to the body torso. The Buddha is seated on the lion throne and the attainment figures are identified as the images of the Padampani and Vajrampani Bodhisattvas, as one holds lotus and other a vajra. Vajra means the thunderbolt. So they wear crowns and are on the either side of the Buddha. The halo around the head of the Buddha is very large and is decorated with the simple geometric motifs. There are two flying figures placed diagonally above the halo and they bear a lot of movement in the picture space. Flexibly replaces the earlier rigidity in the images, giving them a more earthy look, and curves of the body are dedicatedly carved. The upright posture of the Buddha image creates movement in the space, and the face is round with the fleshy cheeks. The bulge of the belly is sculpted with the controlled musculature, and it may be noted that there are numerous examples of the sculptures from Kushana period at Mathura, but the image is representative and is important for understanding of the development of the Buddha image in the subsequent period. Okay, fine. So let's have a look at this image again. So here you will see the total image, so you can observe this. So we have just saw the explanation of this image. Okay, so next we are going to have a look at the image of the Buddha head, Takshila. It is found in the Takshila. Okay, so you can see here this image, right? Okay, so the Buddha head from Takshila in the Gandhara region, now Gandhara region is now in the Pakistan, dates back to the 2nd century CE and belongs to the Kushana period. You need to remember this. This belongs to the Kushana period, and the image shows hybridized pictorial conventions that developed during the Gandhara period. It has the Greco-Roman elements in the treatment of the sculpture and the Buddha. It is quite obvious that this area is in Takshila. Takshila is in the, it is basically Gandhara region now in the Pakistan, and Greeks have came there from northwestern frontier of that part only. So this is a little bit near to the this space. So basically you can say that that's why this has this style has the hybridization of the Greeks and the Indian style basically. So this image shows the hybridized pictorial conventions that developed during the Gandhara period. So in Greco-Roman, so basically Romans and the Greeks, so this has the Greco-Roman elements in the treatment of the sculpture, and the Buddha head has typical Hellenistic elements that have grown over a period of time, and the curly hair of Buddha is thick, having you can see these curly hairs of the Buddha which are having a covered layer of sharp and the linear strokes over the head. Now the forehead planes in the large, having protruding eyeballs, and the eyes are half closed. You can see the eyes are the half closed, and the face and the cheeks are not round like the images found in the other parts of India. So there is a certain amount of the heaviness in the figures of the Gandhara region, and the ears are elongated, especially the ear lobes. Now the treatments of the form bears linearity, and the outlines are sharp, and the surface is smooth. Now the image is very expressive, and the interplay of the light and the dark is given considerable attention by using the curving and the protruding planes of the eye socket and the plane of the nose. Now the expression of the calmness is center point of the attraction. Modeling of the face enhances the naturalism of the three-dimensionality, assimilating various traits of the Achaemenian, Parthian and the Bactrian traditions into the local tradition is a hallmark of the Gandhara style. Now, the Gandhara image have physiognomic features of the Greco-Roman traditions, but they display a very distinct way of treating physiognomic details that are not completely Greco-Roman. Now, the source of the development of the Buddha images has, as well as other, has its genesis in its peculiar geopolitical conditions. It may also be observed that the northwestern part of the India, which is now in Pakistan, always had continuous habitation from proto-historic times, and it continued in the historical period as well. A large number of images have been found in the Gandhara region, and they consist of narratives of the life of the Buddha, narrations from the Jataka stories, and Buddha Bodhisattva images. Okay. So this was about it. Next we are going to see the image of the seated Buddha at Sarnath. So you can have a look at this. It will take some time. Wait for a while. Okay, so you can see this image. This is from Buddha. This is from Sarnath. This image is from Sarnath. Okay. You can see how beautifully it is carved. Now the image of the Buddha from Sarnath belonging to the late 5th century. So you can remember this image is belonging to the late 5th century CE and is housed in the site museum at Sarnath. It has been made in the Chunar sandstone. Remember this image, this sculpture basically made in the Chunar sandstone, and the Buddha is showed seated on the throne in the Padmasana. It represents the Dhamma Chakra Parivartana, and as can be seen from the figures on the thrones, the panel below the throne depicts a chakra, which means a wheel, in the center and deer on either sides with his disciples. Okay, so here you can see the Padmasana. Okay. So the Buddha image is a fine example of the Sarnath school sculpture, and the body is slender and well proportioned but slightly elongated. So the outline are delicate, very rhythmic, and the folded legs are expanded in order to create a visual balance in the picture space. So drapery clings to the body and is transparent to create the effect of integrated volume. The face is round and the eyes are half closed, and the lower lip is protruding, and the roundness of the cheeks has reduced as compared to the earlier images from the Kushana period at Mathura. The hands are shown in Dhamma Chakra Parivartana Mudra, placed just below the chest, and the neck is slightly elongated with the two incised lines indicating folds. The Ushanisha has circular curled hairs, and the aim of the sculptures in ancient India had always been to represent the Buddha as a great human being who achieved the Nibbana, that is the cessation of anger and the hate. And the back of the throne is profusely decorated with the different motifs of flowers and creepers and placed in the concentric circles. And the central part of the halo is a plane without any decoration. It makes the halo visually impressive. Decoration is halo, and the back of the throne indicates the artisan's sensitivity. Sarnath Buddha images of this period shows considerable softness in the treatment of the surface and the volume, and the transparent drapery becomes part of the physical body. Such refinements comes over a period of time, and these features continued in the subsequent periods. There are many other Buddha images in the standing positions from Sarnath, having features like transparent drapery, subtle movements carved separately and placed above the memorial stupas around the Dharmarajika stupa, and these images are now preserved in the Sarnath Museum. So they are either single or with the attendant figures of the Bodhisattvas, Padampani and the Vajrapani. Okay, so next here as you can see the Padampani Bodhisattva, this is basically a painting and it is from the Ajanta cave number 1. Okay. So you can see this image, it is very famous painting, by the way. So this painting on the back of the wall of the interior hall before the shrine, 10 chamber in cave number 1 at Ajanta, dates back to the late 5th century CE, and the Bodhisattvas is holding a Padma, that is lotus, has large shoulders and has three bends in the body, creating a movement in the picture space, and the modeling is soft outline are merged with the body volume, creating the effect of the three-dimensionality, and the figure of the Bodhisattva is wearing a big crown in which detailed rendering is visible. The head is slightly bent to the left and the eyes are half closed and are slightly elongated. The nose is sharp and straight. Light color all over the projected planes of the face is aimed at creating an effect of the three-dimensionality, and the beaded necklace too has similar features. Broad and expanded shoulders creates heaviness in the body, and the torso is relatively round. Lines are delicate, rhythmic and define the contours of the body. The right hand is holding a lotus and the left hand is extended in the space. The Bodhisattva is surrounded by small figures, and the foreshortened right hand of the Bodhisattva make the image more solid and effectively dense. Now the thread over the torso is shown with the fine spiral lines indicating its dimensions, and each and every part of the body is given equal attention. Right, red, brown, green and blue colors are used. Nose projections, incise, end of the lips with the lower lip projections and the small chin contributes to overall effects of the solidity. In the figure compositions and the paintings in the cave number 1 are of good quality and are better preserved. One can observe certain typological and stylistic variations in the paintings of Ajanta, indicating different guilds of the artisans working on the cave painting at Ajanta over the centuries. Now on the other side of the image, Vajrapani Bodhisattva has been painted. So here you can see the Ajanta cave number 2. Here you can see the beautiful painting here. So on the other side of the image, Vajrapani Bodhisattva has been painted, and he holds a vajra in his right hand and wears a crown, and this image also bears the same pictorial quality as the Padampani. Cave number 1 has many interesting paintings of the Buddhist themes such as Mahajanak Jataka, Umang Jataka, etc. And the Mahajanak Jataka is painted on the entire wall side and is biggest narrative painting. It may be observed that the painting of the Padampani and Vajrapani and Bodhisattvas are painted as shrine guardians. Similar such iconographic arrangement is also observed in other caves of the Ajanta. However, Padampani and Vajrapani in the cave number 1 are among the best survived paintings of the Ajanta. So here another painting, you can see the painting of the Mahajanak Jataka Ajanta cave number 1. Okay, now next we are going to see the image of the Maravijaya Ajanta cave number 26. Remember, Maravijaya is in the cave, found in the Ajanta caves, cave number 26. They may ask you in the exam Maravijaya and the cave number, so they may ask you to, you know, join, match the following. So you need to remember Maravijaya is in the cave number 26, Ajanta. So here you can see this sculpture, it is beautifully carved on the walls of the caves. So The theme of the Maravijaya has been painted in the caves of the Ajanta, and this is the only sculptural representation sculpted on the right wall of the cave number 26. It is sculpted near the colossal Buddha image of the Mahaparinibbana, and the panel shows the image of the Buddha in the center surrounded by the Mara army along with his daughter. So the event is part of the enlightenment, and it is personification of the commotion of the mind which the Buddha went through at the time of the enlightenment. Mara represents the desire. According to the narratives, there is a dialogue between the Buddha and the Mara, and the Buddha is shown with his right hand indicating towards earth as a witness to his generosity. Now this relief sculptural panel is highly animated and shows a very matured sculptural style at Ajanta. The composition is very complex with the highly voluminous images, and their complex arrangement in the picture space is highly dynamic and generates considerable movements. The figure on the right shows Mara coming with his army consisting of various kinds of people, including some with a grotesque animal faces, and the dancing figures at lower base with the musicians have forward bulging waist, and one of the dancing figure has expanded her hands in the dancing posture with an angular frontal look. On the left lower end, the image of the Mara is shown contemplating how to disturb Siddhartha and the name of Buddha before enlightenment. The army of Mara is shown marching towards the Buddha in the first half of the panel, whereas the lower half of the panel shows the departing army of Mara giving him adorations. Now the centrally placed Buddha is in the Padmasana, and a tree at the back is shown by the dense leaves. Some of the facial features of the Mara army has tacit characters of the sculptures from Vidarbha. Now the artisans at Ajanta worked in the guilds, and their stylistic affiliations can be traced by identifying such stylistic features. This is the largest sculptural panel at Ajanta, and though there are several big images in the caves of the Ajanta and especially located in the shrines and tea chambers as well as facade walls, such a complex arrangement of the figure is unique. On the other hand, painted panels exhibit such complexities in their arrangement, and the similar kind of arrangements of dancing figures in a panel is also observed at Aurangabad caves. Okay, so with this we have covered cave number 26. Okay, now we are going to see the Mahesh Murthy at Elephanta. So okay, so I'm not going to rotate it now, you can see it this way only. Okay, now there is a need to rotate it, fine, wait for a while. Okay, so here you will see the Mahesh Murthy which is in the Elephanta caves. You must be aware of it. It is near Mumbai. So here you can see the Trimurti, that is Mahesh Murthy image. So the image of the Mahesh Murthy at Elephanta dates back to the early 6th century, and it is located in the main cave shrine in the tradition of the Western Deccan sculpting. It is one of the best example of the qualitative achievement in the sculpting image in the rock cut caves, and the image is large in the size. The central head is main Shiva figure, whereas other two visible heads are the Bhairava and the Uma. Remember, it has the three heads, and the central head is of the Shiva figure, whereas other two are the of Bhairava and Uma, and the central face is in the high relief having the round face with lips and the thick lips and the heavy eyelids, whereas the lower lip is prominently protruded showing the very different characteristics. And the all inclusive aspects of the Shiva is exhibited in this sculpture by soft modeling, smooth surface and the large face. Now the face of the Shiva Bhairava is clearly shown in the profile in an angle with a bulging eye and the mustache, and the other face showing feminine characters of Uma, who is consort of the Shiva. So one of the Shilpa text mentions five integrated faces of the Shiva, and this image, despite being shown with only three faces, is considered as of a same variety, and the top and back faces are deemed as invisible. Each face has a different crown as per its iconographic prescriptions, and this sculpture has been sculpted on the south wall of the cave along with the sculptures of the Ardhanari Nareshwara and the Gandhara panel. So Elephanta sculptures are known for their remarkable qualities of the surface smoothness, elongation, and rhythmic movement. Their composition is very complex, and the iconographic arrangements of this cave is replicated in the cave number 29 of the Ellora. Remember, the iconographic arrangement of this cave is replicated in the cave number 29 of Ellora. Ellora is different. This is Elephanta. Mahesh Murthy is in Elephanta, and the iconographic arrangement of this cave is replicated in which cave number? It is replicated in the cave number 29 of the Ellora. Ellora, remember. Okay, so next we are going to see mural traditions of the India. So here you can see the mural traditions of the India. Here you will see the different images. This is this, then you can see, wait, I'll show you. This is A, remember this, this is A, this is B. You can see here gods and goddesses, and there are different images. You can see, so here is the Ananta, from the Ananta Padmanabha temple. So this is basically this, remember, this is the Ananta from the Ananta Padmanabha temple, Kasagod. Then Shiva chasing the boar, a scene from the Kirtarjuna Lipaksha temple. So here you will see this is the Shiva chasing the temple. This is from the Lipakshi temple. I think this question has been asked in the last year's UPSC exams. I'm not sure, but yes, I think this has been asked somewhere. Then you will see here is the Chola king Raja Raja and court poet Kauar Devar, Thanjavur, 11th century. This painting belongs to 11th century. Then here you will see the Shiva killing the Tripurasura in the Thanjavur. Remember, they may ask you a question in the match the following, so you need to able to answer these questions. So remember, the Shiva killing the Tripurasura in the Thanjavur. Then you will see this image, Rama killing the Ravana. So a scene from a Ramayana panel, Mattancheri Palace. So this scene is from Mattancheri Palace. Rama kills Ravana, a scene from Ramayana panel, Mattancheri Palace. Then here you will see the another image, Shasta. This is the Padmanabhapuram Palace in the Thakkala. Okay. So next chapter is the later Mughal traditions. So this we are going to see in the next video. So till then, keep studying and do subscribe to our channel for more such videos, and do share these videos with friends, your colleagues, anybody you want to share these videos with. Thank you so much for watching.